I'd like to welcome you all to this very important session on intellectual property. It's you know, it's going to be a key area going forward, particularly after COVID, and as we enter new markets. It's something that I know British companies have, you know, have been very concerned about in the past, particularly when you go to a country like China and you know, some of the other Southeast Asian countries. Yeah, we did have one or two problems with IP in Turkey in the early days. I'm going back, you know, to 10, 15 years. Fortunately, things have improved, you know, considerably, and we don't have any concerns about Turkey anymore. And yeah, I think that shows how well Turkish businesses have progressed in terms of corporate governance, in terms of, you know, abiding by, you know, the rules of law when it comes to doing business with other countries. So you know, it's not a big issue as far as UK companies are concerned with regard to Turkey. So that's a good place to be. But yeah, it will continue, you know, to be a concern until, you know, we have, you know, sort of a global understanding that you know, IP has to be protected no matter where you are in the world. And that applies just as much to Turkish companies and their IP as it does to, you know, other countries that their businesses are doing business globally. So I'll just give you a quick update on, you know, where we are with our trade relations with Turkey, which I think is relevant to this. As you're probably aware, we signed a free trade agreement with Turkey on the 29th of December. It was quite a last minute signing. We were all getting very anxious in Turkey to make sure that the you know, the free trade agreement was signed, because it was critical to our future trading relationship with Turkey. And yeah, there was a lot of Turkish companies getting a little bit worried that you know, the deal would not be signed. And the reason why it took so long and why it was complicated, we had to sign, you know, the free trade agreement with the European Union before we were able to sign the free trade agreement with Turkey. And the Turkish government made it very clear that we couldn't sign a free trade agreement with Turkey until we'd signed with the EU. Unfortunately, Santa Claus was very good. He managed to deliver a very nice gift to both UK and the EU, and consequently benefited Turkey as well. So we now have a strong platform to go forward with our trade relations with Turkey. This enables us to, I mean, it's a continuity agreement. It's basically a rollover of our current trade relations that we enjoyed with Turkey before we left the EU. So not too much has changed in that respect. And there is the opportunity to actually build on this continuity agreement. There is a clause in the FTA that enables the two countries to negotiate over the next 2 years to enhance and expand the free trade agreement that we currently have. So, you know, that's all very positive. And, you know, our negotiation team in Ankara will be meeting with the respective ministry, with Minister Pekcan, in the coming months to start those negotiations to bring in more sectors that we previously didn't have access to, and to look at, you know, new investment opportunities, new incentives to bring UK businesses to UK businesses to Turkey. And I mean, we're well aware that you know, Turkey does need foreign investment. I mean, that's very clear. Fortunately, we see a big improvement in the tech sector in Turkey. I mean, it's been growing very, very fast, and the capabilities becoming equal to, you know, any international tech country. So, you know, we see a lot of tech startups in Turkey, and obviously they're looking to expand their businesses. And they looked to UK for funding because London obviously is the capital of a financial capital, which provides funding. I mean, from memory, startups funded in UK in 2019 was around 10 billion. That's an enormous amount of money. But that's where the funding is. And obviously Turkish companies are very keen to access that funding in order to, again, grow and expand the tech sector. And it's an interesting area, tech, when it comes to IP. I'm sure my colleagues will explain that, because it's data protection and other IP protection. Who actually owns the IP when it comes to innovation in technology? It's quite straightforward when it comes to brands. I mean, I worked for Coca-Cola for almost 20 years, so I know a little bit about protecting IP. Particularly in markets where, we had, not quite the control that you would expect in a developed market. I remember back in the days when I was setting up the Coca-Cola operations in Central Asia, we were fighting all the time with almost garage operations in Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan, where guys were using old Coca-Cola bottles and labels and then brewing up some black liquid and passing it off as Coca-Cola. It was small, but at the end of the day, a brand like Coca-Cola cannot be compromised. And we ensured that we took every single situation like that very, very seriously. As I say, I'm going back a long time now. Probably it's changed a bit now. But the area which we'll go into legally, and I think it's very relevant that the strongest way of protecting your IP is understanding the legal aspect and how you can use the law to protect your intellectual property. And that will take up most of this webinar today, because my colleagues here are going to share their knowledge and experience with you and give you some insights as to how legally you can protect your IP. So I'm not going to say too much more. I'll stay on the webinar. If anybody wants to raise a hand and ask me a question, please do. But I'm not really going to get involved in the debate from the legal perspective, because I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not an expert on the legal side. As I say, when it comes to the way we protect intellectual property, either as a brand or a product or some innovation, I have had some experience in that in the past. So with no more ado, I'll hand over. Who's taking the first session? Is it Erdem or?
It will be me, Mr. Dant. Okay. I will be speaking.
So I'll leave it for you. And as I say, we're looking forward to a very interesting and educational session that will bring us up to date with where we stand in terms of legal protection for IP. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dant, for the opening speech. So dear participants, I would like to also welcome you all and thank you for your participation. I also wish to thank BCCT for hosting this IP-oriented event and for the cooperation during the preparation phase of the webinar. We will do our best to give some main aspects of intellectual property rights within 1.5 hours. To be honest, in my usual trainings, it usually takes for me between 2 and 14 days to cover all aspects. So you are all lucky today. I will be talking only for an hour. So let me introduce myself, System Global and our IP division very briefly. I am electronics engineer and I'm Turkish and European patent attorney for almost 20 years. That's it. So let me give some further insight about System Global Group. Yeah. Yes, we founded System Global founded in 1996 in Ankara. And Actually, this year is our 25th year's anniversary. So in 2002, we opened our Istanbul office with a vision to adapt our services to developing R&D ecosystem of Turkey. So in 2018, we started our globalization services with our first abroad office in Brussels, opening the abroad office in Brussels. And now we currently have more than 320 professionals, in-house professionals in our team. Yeah, so we have 8 offices in Turkey and 4 offices in abroad. I mean, London, Berlin, Singapore, and Brussels office. Currently serve more than almost 2,000 actual clients, Turkish and international clients. Also, our services actually includes 2 branches. One is compliance and the other one is consulting branches. In compliance side, we provide tax and other services, legalization and risk and process management services, technical payroll solutions, and financial advisory services. While in the consulting side, we provide R&D innovation and fund management in global and local perspectives, IP services, I mean intellectual property services, and also some software services for managing information and R&D activities, and also M&A, corporate finance and investment consultancy is among our services provide for almost more than 20 years. In our IP division, actually, I am the head of IP division. So the company is Erdem Kaya Patent. The company merged with System Global 1 year ago. In IP division, we have more than 40 IP professionals, and including me, our partners have more than 20 years of IP experience. So we are known team in Turkey for IP aspects, actually. And we do all IP services from filing to litigation, including valuation, freedom to operate, and the like patent search, etc. So let me start, let's get into the IP issues. In the forwards, actually, I just want to give some main aspects of IP in terms of organization, actually. Organizations such as companies, universities, or even a governmental body, actually, have 3 main assets, which are tangible assets, financial assets, and intangible assets. So until the beginning of the new millennium, tangible and financial assets, including buildings, equipments, I mean, inventory, stock, cash money, etc., were more important than intangible assets. But in this period of time, actually, intangible assets create real value of all competitive organizations. Their value usually tens or even 100 times than that of tangible and financial assets. So let me give some detail about intangible assets. You can see from the slide that actually, we can say 3 intangible assets as 3 main branches. Of course, human assets is most important one. Without human intelligence, nothing can be created in respect of IP. So the knowledge, talent, experience, employee satisfaction, employee commitment, education, and blah, blah, all attributes of employers create total human assets. So the other one is structural assets. I mean, culture, management philosophy, management systems, procedures, policies, know-how, documentation, corporate memory, trade secrets, databases, software codes, and of course, if we protect these structural assets in legal way, then it becomes our intellectual property rights. I will be explaining detail in the following slides. Also, intangible assets includes relational assets. This is, let's as an example, your strategic partnerships, product and service quality, your trademark reputation, your marketing channels, or your relation with clients, supplier, or governments, etc. These all create the relation asset of an organization. So intangible asset, again, far more valuable than the all other assets of an organization. So here an example. I have a question, actually. Maybe you can, by the way, you can ask your question via Q&A session. If you write down into a chat session, I may not be able to see. But if you write to the Q&A session, I will do our best to answer your question as long as our time is enough. So you can see left side, this is the, maybe some of you know, this is the Apple Park. I mean, the main headquarters of Apple, and the right one, right side is actually, you all know, this is the Apple logo. So let's compare their values. So the all, I mean, building, equipments, etc. cost up to $5 billion. So if I want to buy Apple Park, I need to pay at least $5 billion. But if I want to buy Apple trademark, its value is more than $170 billion. So you can see the differences actually. It is almost 40 times higher than the tangible assets. So actually this is only value of trademark. When it comes to patent, I mean, value of the Apple's patent is far more higher. So I would say that the IP adds soul to products and services. So if you put this logo, for example, on an ordinary glass cup, its price increases for several times and probably customers will tend to buy the cup with Apple logo by paying more. So this is this shows the value of an effect of the IP. So I also give another insight. Maybe some of you know the European Patent Office, the main organization in European region, and the European Patent Office simply checks the, for example, if you file a European patent application, they check whether there is any previous application, there is any prior art, and decide whether to patent the invention or not, simply. It's a big organization, and every year they releases a very important report. So this is one of them. It shows the strategic importance of IP. And here are some figures from this European Patents Office reports. In this report, the contribution of IPR intensive companies to EU economy was analyzed for years between 2014 and 16. As you see from the first figure, actually, industries that make intensive use of IPR, such as patents, trademarks, or copyright, generate 45% of EU's total GDP, amounting 6.6 trillion euro annually. As seen from the graphic in the middle, such industries, I mean IPR intensive industries, provided 84 million jobs, covering 39% of total EU employment. And in the last figure, we see that patent intensive industries can pay 72% higher wage to their employees. So compared to non-IPR intensive industries. So of course, many other examples can be given, but we have very limited time actually. Just I wanted to show this report. This really shows how IP affects a region in economic aspects. So in this slide, I wish to show all branches of intellectual property rights. Ahu will be giving details for some of them, and I will be giving some of them. So in a nutshell, trademarks protect signs that distinguish your goods and services with others' goods and services. As you all know, domain names is on internet online representation. Patent and utility models protects technical inventions. I will be giving, of course, details about patents and utility models. Designs protects aesthetic visual shape of an article. It could be three-dimensional or two-dimensional, like patterns. Copyright protects artistic works, poems, movies, music, but also software code, databases, and pictures. Know-how is a general idea, general actually concept, because actually know-how is precursor of IP rights. So for example, you just draft the invention disclosure form and it becomes the know-how, but then we draft a patent application and file a patent application, then it becomes patent right. So know-how actually all written corporate memory of an organization for me. It could be a trade secret as well, very confidential information of the companies. Also, we have geographical indications. This protects the product of origins or product of indication. Plant varieties protect newly discovered and developed plant varieties. And also, finally, IC integrated circuits topographies protects three-dimensional configurations of electronic circuits embedded in an integrated circuit. So in this example, actually, I just wish to summarize all some of IP instruments in this product. We all know this is a pointer device. I used to use this before pandemic, actually, very frequently. Now we are using Zoom. So this is the daily life example. So you can see that This is trademark Logitech, and its logo is a trademark registered in certain classes. This outer appearance, this is very good actually aesthetic shape. So it is protected by design registration. So maybe this slight changing system of this device can be protected by patent, if of course if they are the first inventor of this system. Another example, maybe at the beginning, for example, I invented only slight changing system, but after a certain time of use, I noticed that we need something further, and invented laser pointer feature and add them to this device, and it can also be patented actually. Another patent example, for example, in the beginning, it has receiver and the transmitter, so you may lose your receiver because there is separate item. So I invented an housing that into which this receiver can be plugged. So this could be another actually patent also. So I will be explaining utility model is for more straightforward inventions. I mean, utility model is not exist in all countries, but in Turkey it's possible. Like, you can see that this design actually gives also some functionality. It is not only aesthetic appearance, but you see the narrowing section, let's say waist section, it provides ergonomy to the main body of the pointer. So it can be protected by utility model application as well in Turkey. Let's continue. Sorry. So maybe in a company which can manufacture this product, or which can sell this product, for example, mold data, electronic circuit shim, production documentation, user manuals, or some maybe a business development documents, etc., all can be considered as a know-how. And also the software codes inside the chip and also client database, for example, can be regarded as a copyright. So we can see most of IP instruments only this device that we use in our daily life. I hope you understand a bit better what IP means. Let me continue. So I will be starting patent actually. This is my actual expertise area. But before explaining patent, let me explain what the invention is according to, of course, patent laws. But to be honest, in the patent law in the world, patent laws generally do not define the invention, not to limit its scope. But if you find a technical solution to a technical problem, I have a very good news for you actually. You are an inventor, whether it's a very straightforward solution or very complicated solution. To become an inventor, you don't need to be a Albert Einstein or Steve Jobs. If you spot a solution, it's problem, and if you solve this problem in a novel way, then you are inventor. That's it. So also the another issue, on the other hand, I wish to give some insight about what is non-technical according to the patent laws. Maybe you can see from the beginning, I said technical solution to a technical problem. So this means any inventions, let's say, which do not provide technical solutions to a technical problems cannot benefit from patent protection. So for example, problems based on taste, aesthetics, issues, fun, business methods, and administrative issues are all non-technical. And in most cases, such solutions cannot benefit from patent protection. For example, if you cannot patent card game as a whole, but you can patent game cards. You can patent game cards with a cover preventing wearing in time. So this is technical side, but the game is not a technical. It's just fun. It's just taking your time. But if you provide a solution which prolongs wearing of the game cards, then you can patent, of course, this, for example, covering material. By the way, what's the power of patent compared to other IP instruments? So actually, patent is the single IP instrument that can protect main technical idea, or in other words, generic version of your solution, which may cover hundreds of variants. So it provides much wider protection compared to other IP instrument. But as I said, to benefit from patent protection, you must have a technical solution. Otherwise, you cannot benefit from the patent protection. So I will be giving some examples in the following slides. So also, this is the first hurdle actually. It is not hard to overcome this hurdle, but there is another hurdle. These are called patentability criteria. We have three criteria to meet if you want a patent protection. First one is novelty. What is novelty? Actually, there should be no similar solution in the prior art, which covers all, prior art covers all information in the world in a written or oral form, somehow made available to public before a patent application date. Or even the prior art covers any information revealed for example, in use activity, such as by marketing your product before the patent filing date. So to meet the novelty criteria, there should be no prior art in the world. Even for example, I want to get a patent protection in Turkey, but there is a prior art in United States, a patent publication. The US patent publication prevents me from getting a patent in Turkey because novelty must be in the whole world. We say it's absolute novelty. So for inventive step criteria, actually it is a bit subjective criteria, and actually I can explain how it's interpreted for several days. It's a very huge topic, but I just want to give some, I just want you to make familiar with this criteria. So for example, an invention which is not obvious to a skilled person in the art, in the light of prior art, is considered as involving an inventive step. I am sure it's not still so clear to you. Let me formulate the criteria with some examples. If there are similar solutions to similar problems in your technical field of activity, your solution is not inventive probably. Once you spot a technical problem, if you find a very straightforward solution, again, your solution probably is not inventive. I will be giving, of course, further examples. This another issue, patent is negative rights. Patent prevents others from making use of your invention. Patents do not give you right to manufacture. This is actually a misunderstood aspect. So this is very important. For example, if we go back to our previous example, for example, I invented the pointing device. And I marketed the device, I'm getting good money, but another entrepreneurs, they solve a problem. So he invented, for example, the laser pointing feature. So he can get patent for laser pointing feature, no problem at all. But if he manufactured this product without getting license from me, it infringes my patent because the core technology is mine. I patented the core technology, the other guy added a feature to core technology and then commercialized it without my consent. So this means there is a patent infringement. So his patent cannot give him the right to manufacture. Only right to prevent others from using your invention. I hope it's clear. So I think there's another question here. I will be replying questions in the end of my session. Also, please use Q&A session if possible for you. I may miss because from the chat site. Let me continue. Yes. Patent provides 20 years of protection in the whole world. It cannot be extended. When the patent expires, your technology becomes public, so everyone can use the core technology. And also, it takes 2 or 4 years for a patent to be granted in Turkey or even in UK, maybe, or even in Europe. Sometimes even longer, 8 years, 9 years. It can happen, especially in, for example, let's say chemistry or medicine patents. It can be longer. So I also wish to give some information about utility models. Actually, it is ideal for straightforward inventions. To be honest, utility model is not exist in all countries. For example, I don't think there is a utility model protection in United Kingdom, but it is possible in Germany, it's possible in Italy and Spain. But Turkey has some differences because in Turkey, the inventive step criteria is not required for utility model. But for example, many other countries requires certain level of inventiveness benefiting from utility model protection. So in Turkey, if your invention is novel, you can easily get utility model protection. It is big opportunity, actually. Let's say you cannot, for example, you file European patent application, but you cannot get patent, but you can get a utility model in Turkey for certain features. But the hardest, the processes and chemical formulations cannot be protected by utility model in Turkey. And utility model provides in Turkey 10 years of protection. It may vary in other countries, but in Turkey, it provides 10 years of protection. And it takes a few years, one or two years to get granted. So there is a question from Mr. or Ms. Seyhan, I don't know. Could you give information regarding trademark partner for a consultancy advisor methodology? Is it possible in Turkey? Okay, I will be replying at the end of my speech. Thank you for question. Let me continue. I actually want to give a very basic example so that you can understand patentability criteria easily. So here is a speaking stand. I used to use this stand before pandemic when I giving lectures or trainings. And you know, when I was giving training, I get hot and want to take off my jacket. And I saw that there is no function in speaking stand to hang my jacket. So this is very simple technical problem. Usual speaking stand cannot allow us to hang, for example, our jacket on them. So what is the solution? Of course, it's so easy to actually anticipate. It is, we can add a hanger to the speaking stand. So let's check the patentability criteria. First, is this a technical solution problem? Yes. Is the function technical functional, actually? We are adding a technical function to speaking stand. So is it novel? Let's say, of course, it's just, we are imagining. Of course, hangers are used in all type of furnitures, but if no one is offered any use of a hanger in a speaking stand, our invention is novel, that's it. So what I mean, we are now eligible for utility model protection. I solved the technical problem with a technical way and my invention is new. So I can get utility model for such a straightforward invention. So I can say, for example, when I drafted my utility model specification, I say a speaking stand comprising an hanger, at least one hanger, that's it. So this provides me 10 years of protection. For example, if another competitor comes and add two hangers to the stand, or maybe a hanger with very different shape, whatsoever they do, they infringe my utility model right, that's it. But if I want to patent this invention, it is not possible, because this is very obvious solution, because in the furniture field, hangers are well known. So I cannot patent, but I can get utility model. Let me continue. I hope it is better understood what the criteria. So it's another chat, I think. Let me continue. Also, of course, I'm talking about patent, but maybe some of you never have seen any patent specification. I just give some snapshots from the patent document, actually. This is, for example, one of our clients, Arzu. Maybe you all know Okka, very famous Turkish coffee making machine in Turkey. We manage all IP, actually, issues of the Okka and Arzu as a whole. So this is, for example, European patent grant of the Okka coffee machine, a full automatic Turkish coffee cooking and serving machine. This is the title of the invention. This is filing date, is a European patent grant date, is a representative and inventor, etc. You can see this is the publication page of grant. So this is some of the drawings where we're using patents and real appearance of the Okka. This, as you see, our is very boring while the real life is very good. So, but in patent applications, we have to use such drawings. I mean, we cannot use photos, etc. This is the patent specification includes a technical field where we give main, what the technical field, main technical field is. Also, we have prior art section. In the prior art section, we disclose all previous solutions and disadvantages of the previous solutions to a certain extent, of course. For example, we just refer to some patent applications, previous patent applications for similar subject matters. Also, in the brief description of the invention, we provide our purpose, our technical problem, which we solve by this invention. Also, there is a brief description of figures section. In this section, we just explain the define the figures that we use in patent application. We have reference number section. Of course, we have hundreds of sometimes reference numbers. We just, let's say, take every feature of the device. So, I mean, the resolution of a patent attorney should be very high, actually. For example, if a new patent attorney or if a new patent attorney candidate, maybe he can find 10 reference number, but an experienced patent attorney can find maybe hundreds of reference numbers in a product inventor invention to be patented. So also there's a detailed description section. It may last for tens of, sometimes hundreds of pages actually. This is only snapshot from beginning. So in the detailed description, we disclose all details of a preferred embodiment of an invention. So by referring to figures and the reference numbers in the figures. And also most important part is claims, because claims define the scope of protection. So when drafting claims, we always use more generic terms to widen our scope of protection, because our main motivation is that our patent should not be circumvented by competitors. So actually claim drafting is an art, to be honest. And it really takes many years to draft good claims. So I just want us to give some patent attorney touch to an invention. So let's say we invented the handle, 2000 years ago. What's the main problem? If we cannot hold the glass when there is a hot liquid inside it. So I just invented this shape of handle and I just want to protect it. I go to a patent attorney and say, I ask for him or her help. So, for example, in case of a narrow claim, this patent attorney can draft a claim in this way. Let's say a glass cup comprising a handle provided in the lateral surface thereof. Sorry, I just made a mistake here. So, in a closed shape, I mean, with a narrow definition. And also, we say glass cup, for example. So, but this cup should not be in glass, or this handle should not be in closed form. So circumvention is very easy. But in this white claim, but I have a mistake, sorry, because this is the, I think, repetition of the narrow claim. It should be in this way, a cup. We should not say glass. A cup comprising a projection, which is configured to reduce heat transfer. So this provides much wider protection. I mean, because even if I make metal cup, still it infringes the patent. And even if I make a open shape, I mean not closed shape projection, still it is the projection still infringes my patent right. So drafting claims is very important for patents. Another issue is exploiting patent data. Maybe some of you know. Patent data is public, so for almost so you can access all technical, all patent history of the world from the, for example, 18th century. So huge data, and it's all public. You can search the data and retrieve very inside information from that data. So this is, we always advise our clients to be familiar about patent novelty searches. You can do it on your own, or you can hire a patent attorney to do so. So patent novelty search is important. If you are making R&D, you must do the patent search in the beginning of the R&D stages, and also in the middle, or even in the end. This is a live, actually, activity. You always must be checking the patent data, because otherwise there is risk of patent infringement. Also, there is risk of R&D duplicating. I mean, you maybe the invention that you work on it maybe already invented by another person. So you must know that so that you can pivot your idea from the others' patents. So also you can we can conduct validity operate searches. I mean, this is very important also. I mean, to spot any patent infringement risks. There are thousands of millions of patents in the globe. So it is something like a minefield. So if you want to run over a, actually, if you want to walk on a minefield, you should know the places of mine so that you do not step on a mine and then get hurt. This is why we do the freedom to operate searches. We just check all patent infringement risk in a geographical regions that our clients want to market their inventions. Also, we use the patent data for designing around the patent. For example, it happens sometimes. Let's say our clients wants to market his invention in Germany, but we find a German patent and it our solution infringes that German patent. So we just start to think about how to circumvent from that patent, scope of the patent. So this is also what this is what we do in our daily actually life as a patent attorney. We also conduct patent invalidity searches. I mean, let's say we realize that we cannot design around a patent. So then it's another option. We try to kill the patent, let's say. So we just check further prior art. We check, maybe we check some mistakes in the patent specification to find any way to invalidate the patent or at least to narrow its scope for protection so that our client finds a free place to move forward. Also, we prepare patent landscape reports. This is also very important. For example, we say blue ocean. We, for example, we have a you have a company and you focus on, let's say, electronic hardware stuff. But you want to expand your business to artificial intelligence solutions. So this is blue ocean for you. And in the beginning, you should know which are your competitors, what's your IP and patent activity, what are the most popular technical fields that they patent, how their filing trend, etc., etc. This is a big report, and it really gives very good insights for new areas that you want to get in. Let me continue. Also, we provide patent-based competitor and technology watch services. This is also very important because, you know, for example, we make a patent search, we can reveal all information up to now, but in every month, there will be adding further patent applications from your competitors or from your sector. So we should also be not spotting such applications to make our technical level update or to maybe to spot any legal risk actually. So it can be done. Also, the last one is very popular nowadays, finding someone to cooperate, especially for R&D aspects. I mean, maybe you can find employee to employee. Let's say you are in a the mobile communication sector. You see that there are some inventors having maybe more than 50, 60 patents. So these guys are very good to transfer, actually. Also, you can make a project partner to make a joint R&D. Let's say you can find a startup company. You can find academic company or maybe tech startup by spotting their patent application, and you can maybe make investment to them, for example. Also, you can find academicians having patents to transfer his know-how to your organization. These are only some examples. Let me continue. I will check, yes, my time as well. So let me give the patenting procedure in a very simplified way because it actually includes many steps. I just want to give only a few of them, which may sound something to you. I'm opening. So as I said, we should start always with patent novelty search before filing. It can be done in a week. So then if the patents, if the, for example, if you see that the invention is novel, then it's good to file a patent application. So drafting, we start to draft a patent application and file before a national patent office, for example, from Turkish patent office, or maybe even regional patent office, like European patent office. It depends on the strategy. It takes a month to conclude this actual step. So the national patent office makes some formal checks from patent application. It says it's last few months, I said third month. And then we should be filing an abroad patent application if you expand our geographical scope within 1 year. In 18 months of from the filing, usually the patent search is completed and your patent is published in a patent bulletin. And in the second year, the patent examination starts and it is completed. In the patent examination, the examiners in the National Patent Office check your invention, whether your invention meets all the patentability criteria, for example. It can be at the end, it could be a negative report, then you will have right to respond their objections or their some considerations in the examination report. And you usually get a grant decision and pay the grant fee within the third year from as from the filing date, and you get the patent certificate within in third year. But as I said, it could be longer, up to 6 years, 7 years, 8 years. And also you have to pay patent annuities every year. In Turkey, it starts from the third year, but it changes from country to country. But of course, as I noted here, this procedure is given for a smooth process where there is no negative examination report or any post-grant oppositions. If this happens, the procedure gets longer. So let me give some information about patenting abroad as well. So our purpose to get abroad protection actually is to prevent others from making use of my invention in the regions where I have a market, or at least market potential. Because if I don't get patent in those countries, I cannot stay competitive because there will be counterfeit products and I will not be able to prevent them from copying my solutions. So this is why I need patent protection in all possible markets. So IPRS is national actually, unless you take actions for abroad protection. In patent, you have 1 year to go abroad. If you miss the 1 year period, then you cannot protect your invention in abroad. This is very critical term. Of course, as a patent attorney, we do monitor this term and remind our clients for several times and ask them whether you want to abroad protection or not. And if you wish, for example, to protect your invention in a few countries, like let's say United Kingdom and Germany, you can directly file a conventional patent application in these countries by using IP firms in those countries. This is what we do. But if you want wider coverage, I mean Europe, China, United States, maybe Eurasia, then the best option is to file PCT application. PCT is Patent Cooperation Treaty, and Turkey is part of the treaty as well. There are more than 160 actually countries are already part of this treaty. So we usually use this PCT application. It gives us a time. All the patent procedures are handled in a single body to a certain extent. And at the end of the PCT's international phase, I do the national or regional phase entries via PCT system. It is the best option for abroad protection, abroad patent protection. There are also some regional systems. We say, for example, European Patent Convention. There are, I think, more than 40 members already in European Patent Convention. Turkey is also among members. There is a Eurasian patent system, the OAP and ARIPO systems for African countries, and also Gulf for Gulf countries, GC system. So these are all can be used in designing your strategy for abroad protection. Of course, we do help our clients when designing this strategy because there are many parameters. Also, budgeting is important. So we must do a precise, actually, and delicate handling for abroad protection. Otherwise, the budgets really go very high. So just I want to give some patent figures. Maybe I can ask what's the number of total patent applications in the world in 2020? It's about 3 million. patent applications was filed in the last year. In Turkey, we filed approximately 1,000 patent and utility model application in total. So Turkey's number of filing is getting higher in every year, actually. This is good. So as a summary, what is the benefit of an IP culture in your organization, actually? This is very important. You can protect your R&D efforts and cope with counterfeits and stay competitive. Otherwise, it's not possible to stay competitive. You can watch latest technological activities of your competitors or your technical field. You can slow down your competitors. I mean, by filing many patent applications, you just slow down them. They have to wait maybe until your patent is concluded. So it may be sometimes it gives you a few years to freely act actually. Also, you can prevent your competitors from blocking your R&D studies by filing a relevant patent application. Covering your R&D projection as well. This is a very risky situation. You can avoid from duplicate R&D and patent infringement. You can increase value of your company. As I said, the intangible asset, the most valuable asset of an organization. So if you have more patents, if you manage trademark very well, your value of your company increases dramatically. Especially in M&A procedures, it really helps to increase the value of the company. You can license your IP maybe for regions or sectors where you are not active. For example, I cannot have an activity in Brazil, but I have a patent and cover, and also it's registered also in Brazil. And there is a very big company that can use my technology in Brazil. So I can license my technology and get really good money only from licensing of my patent. Also, you can use your IP as a legal shield in case of any legal dispute. If you have a huge patent portfolio, actually, there are always solutions to solve such dispute in an alternative resolution way. And also, you can benefit from supports and incentives very more efficiently, actually. I will be skipping this slide because I have only a few minutes to finish my site, actually. So as I said, there is another issue topic is patent box regime in Turkey. So let me explain what's the patent box regime in a nutshell. First, its purpose is to contribute to sustainability of a company's R&D efforts and to promote their patent generation. To achieve this, patent box regime provides reasonable corporate tax exemptions for profits, including those generated by selling a patented invention or revenues obtained by licensing or transferring the patent, right, as I just mentioned. As you can see from the mapping on the right, even in EU region, 18 countries, including 14 EU and 4 non-EU members are already applying patent box regime, including United Kingdom, of course. It's worth emphasizing that Turkey is amongst countries offering highest tax deduction under the patent box regime. Let me continue. So let me explain how the patent box regime was started in Turkey. In 2014, an article with the title of Exemption in the Industrial Property Rights was added to corporation tax law. In the first version of the patent box regime, the tax benefit was limited to 50% of the patent value. So for this reason, it was required to submit a patent variation report to benefit from such a tax exemption, but it did not work actually. The good news is that the condition was changed in the 2016, and since then, there is no limit in tax benefit, and it is not required to submit a patent valuation report anymore. Even though we, of course, calculate the value of patent, but we do not have to submit the report. By the way, it's worth reminding that usual corporate tax rate in Turkey is now 22% of the net profit. So in this slide, I just listed the conditions which shall be met in a whole to benefit from the exemption. Please note that if you fail to meet even one of these conditions, this means you are outside of a patent box regime. First, you must have a valid Turkish patent certificate issued after official patent examination procedures, or a valid Turkish utility model certificate issued as a result of a positive novelty search report prepared by Turkish Patent and Trademark Office. The second, you must realize all R&D processes of the patented invention in Turkey, including software development studies. The third, you also have to manufacture the patented invention in Turkey or to use the patented method in a production process in Turkey. In addition to above, for example, exclusive license holders of a patent or utility model, right, of course, conforming to below these conditions, can also benefit from the tax exemptions. Actually, for the latter, this, for example, really catalyzes cooperation between startups and industry companies. Because if an industry company obtains an exclusive license, for example, from a startup, they not only will be able to access the technology they need, but they will also will be eligible for a patent box regime. So this is a very good way to connect big companies and startups, or maybe academic companies. Let me continue. As regards the coverage of the patent box, the incomes obtained in the following cases will be exempted from the corporate tax at rate of 50%. You may see that revenues derived from the transferring or licensing a patent or utility model right, profits derived from sales of a product, profits derived from a sales of a product manufactured by a patented process. And also maybe insurances or compensations obtained as a result of patent infringements also covered by this patent box regime. Actually, this is very important, especially this second and third items are very important, because in Turkey it is rare to license an IP right, but there are many companies already marketing their patented products. Many companies, they are using patented manufacturing methods to produce their products. So these companies are now eligible for patent protection. This is a very huge opportunity for companies. Also, it's another final issue. Revenues obtained from licensing or assigning a patent utility model right also exempted from VAT, which is at the rate of 18% in Turkey. Finally, this is my last slide, actually. I just want to give some other IP-related supports and incentives in Turkey. Actually, Turkey really has a growing R&D and innovation ecosystem. There are many startups. There are thousands of R&D centers, technology transfer offices, incubation centers, so on. So this is why the Turkish government does provide some supports and incentives for such actually bodies. So TÜBİTAK, I mean the Scientific and Technological Research Council of Turkey, supports cost of abroad patent filings up to 50% in certain stages. Of course, there are many details of this support, but I just give some main aspects I want to give. COSGAP, this SME development organization of Turkey, supports all official fees of patent, utility model, and design filings of SMEs, as well as professional fees of a patent attorneys at a rate of 60% within limits. Turkish Ministry of Trade supports costs of international trademark registration up to 70% rate. On the other hand, if a Turkish company having an approved R&D center increases number of its granted patents at 20% rate and also increases its R&D expenditures compared to previous year, then the company pays even more reduced corporate tax. Finally, if a company obtains a license for a patent from a Turkish university or becomes new owner of the IP patent right, license or assignment fees and relevant consultancy costs such as license contract drafting or patent valuation is supported up to 75% rate under TÜBİTAK technology transfer program. This is very interesting, and now there is new one just released. We call 1702 program. So in this program, TÜBİTAK does support technology transfer costs, including royalty fees or patent assignment fees. So I am confident to say that Turkey does offer IP-friendly ecosystem for local and international companies. So this is the end of my slides. I hope I could give valuable and some good insights to all of you participants. Now I think it is Ahu's turn. Ahu, you can share your slides and we can continue. We cannot hear Ahu. Maybe open your microphone.
Hi everyone. Can you hear me right now, right?
Yes, we can.
Okay.
We can hear.
And can you see my screen is at the same time?
Yes, yes.
Oops, sorry. Okay. I need to come where you stop. Sorry for that. So while I'm coming to the my slide, maybe I can introduce myself just a little bit. I'm Ahu Güneyli, actually attorney at law, registered before Istanbul Bar. And I'm a trademark attorney registered before Türk Patent as well. And I've been practicing IP like more than 15 years with holding also a master's degree in IP law. So, thanks for everyone who are still here with us because, you know, it's like more than an hour right now, and I request a little bit more of your patience, and I promise I will try to make it really fast and finish also for the questions and answers. And finally, I also request you to submit your questions from questions and answers. So in the end, we can check and respond them accordingly. So okay. So I first want to start with the IP milestones in Turkey, let's say. So we need to also cover Ottoman Empire because until 1994, we even haven't had a patent and IP office in Turkey. And in 1871, Ottoman Empire adopted first trademark law, and 1879, first invention law, which can be referred as patent law, was accepted in Ottoman Empire. But when Turkish Republic is established, there was no codes, no laws for the protection of IP rights, actually. So in 1951, the first code in the area of intellectual property, let's say, was accepted, but it is general copyrights law, we can say. It's intellectual and artistic works law code, and it's mainly protecting copyrights, and it is still in effect, in force for copyright works as well. But, you know, for example, for trademarks, logos, designs, some kind of inventions, maybe subject to the copyright as well. So when you create a logo, it is also, you know, a work of art. So you can maybe protect your right through copyright law with this code as well. But thankfully now we have different and special particular IP laws for trademarks, patents, and other IP rights other than the copyright. So again, in 1994, Turkish Patent Institute, which was called back then, was founded. And since 1995 to 2017, our IP rights, like patents, industrial designs, and trademarks, were being regulated by degree laws. You know, this was causing many problems in Turkey because especially for the people's right, you know, individual rights, personal rights, and it was like the constitutional court was canceling, revoking some articles day by day. And that's why there was a really strong need for an IP code. And in 2017, our new updated and mostly prepared in accordance with EU directive IP code has been ratified and now in force finally. Of course, there are still some you know, things to develop, but it develops, and you know, the seminars, the webinars, and The EU practice also, you know, affects Turkish laws as well. So what is trademark? Let's begin with the trademarks. I will again go very quickly because, you know, these are, as Erdem said, these can be covered for hours. Each section can be covered for hours, but this time we are just giving the key notes, highlights of the concepts and, you know, rights. I'll try to keep it short. So what is trademark? As Erdem said, trademark is signs that distinguishes your goods and services that you offer from the other companies, other businesses, goods and services. That can be anything, like personal names. When I, you know, give this presentation and say personal names, I have to, you know, cite Erdem Kaya patent as an example of this personal names. So, for example, it's a good trademark, Erdem Kaya patent on.
It's kind of your
section of IP laws, IP rights, right? So it can be figures, I mean logos, like you see from the System Global Danışmanlık logos. There's a really distinctive logo, which can be also protected by trademark, which is also, by the way. Letters, numbers, sounds, motions, and the shape of goods of or their packing can be trademarked. So the important thing here is Türk Patent requires the signs to be represented on the register. I mean, you can you should be giving some definite particulars to Türk Patent to have them register the right on this on the registry. What does it mean? It means, for example, smells. Smells cannot be trademarked in Turkey, but in some countries, like in the United States, it can be actually protected as a trademark. For example, give me an example. For example, the smell of Play-Doh, the, you know, toy dough for the children. So this can be protected in other countries, but not in Turkey, actually. So I'll give you some examples of the figures, shape of goods and their packing, for example. Just ignore the Toblerone letters and just focus on the chocolate, okay? So when you see this chocolate, you can directly understand and think that this is Toblerone, right? So that shape distinguishes Toblerone's goods from other chocolates. So that can be trademarked as well. And you can see the Türk Patent registry reports just behind the photo of the Toblerone. So motions, who doesn't know this motion, right? So this is also a good example that motions, like, not stable pictures, logos only, but also motions can be protected as trademark and can be distinguish your goods and services from the other businesses' goods and services. So this is a color mark. When I show this, most probably you remember, and I say this is for chocolates. Most probably you remember what is it, right? Which chocolate it refers to. For example, in Turkey, it's Milka. And there's another example for colors for chocolates, actually purple color in for chocolates in the UK, which was accepted for Cadbury, right? So when you say a package colored with purple, you can say, this is a good chocolate coming from Milka, or, you know, Cadbury as well. So what is the function, what are the functions of the trademark? It first distinguishes your goods and services from the others' goods and services, we told that. But it also indicates the source of origin. As I said, when I say purple or when I said a logo, I immediately think that it comes from that company. For example, when I say see iPhone trademark, then I can relate with the Apple company, and that's, you know, is a good example of indication of source of origin. The other function is advertisement and investment abilities, which means actually trademark sells itself. So Erdem also mentioned this function when it's in the beginning of his presentation. So I will just pass it so quickly. But you know, it sells when you trademark a glass or something, its value, you know, immediately changes, and you can sell it for higher prices. And also, it also helps you to invest on your trademark, like advertising, like publishing something, and etc. So if you don't have a trademark, your goods and services, like say services, might not be advertisable if you are not, you know, really distinguishing, doing something really rare. It also guarantees the quality because, for example, if again, let's go with Apple trademark. When you see some kind of you know, a trademark that is you know, belong to Apple, then you trust it. And Apple also guarantees its quality that it will be the same quality as we guarantee and as we do with our other goods and services as we provide as usual. So you can trust the company behind when you see the trademark. Finally, it, you know, enables to take legal actions against all infringers, copycats, similar applications, and to enforce your rights, you really need a registration. I said it, but I will tell, you know, I need to put a disclaimer here for designs. I will tell just a few slides later for the registered, you know, enforceable of registered trademarks, rights. So what can be trademark? I will also refer this as grounds, absolute grounds of refusal, which means when you file these marks, these things as a trademark, patent examiners will refuse it provisionally. I mean, per se, you don't need, there's no need of opposition, or there's no need of third party involving third party. Third patent absolutely, you know, says no, you can't trademark this. And this is just not for Türk patent or Turkish law. This is kind of many of them, kind of a global thing. And it is, you know, same for even if you go to Hong Kong and try to register, for example, jewelry for rings, you will get the answer of no, unfortunately. That means absolute grounds of refusal. So what are they? Non-distinctive signs, descriptive signs, generic ones, common words, deceptive signs. For example, we started with Apple, let's go with Apple. For example, you, let's say Apple is not a well-known trademark, just a trademark, because for well-known trademarks, you can block in other classes for other goods and services as well. So let's say you can't do that with Apple and you want to register Apple for fruits. You can't, because obviously you can't own the word, right? Because it will be unfair for the other ones. For example, let's say you want to register your apple word for confectionery. You can't, because this time it will be deceptive, because the consumer can be deceptive and wrongly thought it was an apple, real apple, not a sugar and artificial some kind of harmful thing. So this will be deceptive. So it can't be registered. Also for signs that contain religious values or symbols like mosque, or, you know, it depends. It mostly depends on the culture of the country. But, you know, there are some sensitivities for something, and while in other countries it was not. So that can be changeable, actually. The other things like the indications or signs used by everyone in the trade area. Like, I can't register attorney or lawyer for my for legal services that I'm providing, because it's a common name of the job, right? And also, you can't register signs which are of public interest and which contain historical, cultural emblems, badges, or, you know, that kind of visuals within. Also, you can't register geographical signs or even the trademarks containing geographical signs. You can't register it as a trademark. And finally, this is only for Turkey for now. I mean, comparing to EU and UK, you can't register an identical or similar, next to identical, almost identical trademarks for the same identical or really similar goods and services in Turkey. Türk Patent says absolute no in the beginning of your application. So there's no need for the earlier right owner to oppose to this identical trademark. For UK and for the EU, actually, the offices, EUPO or UK IPO, they just notified the earlier right owner that there's a really identical trademark was filed. And if you want to oppose, please, you know, oppose it in 2 months. Otherwise, I will register it. So EU and the UK informs the earlier right owner. Turkey, Türk Patent, it does not warns, or it does not informs the earlier right owner, but refuses as a absolute ground refusal when you file the identical application. So this is the one of the differences of the EU and UK law with the Turkish law. So the others can be, you know, these ones are not refused by the Türk Patent, but I mean, of course, initially the Türk Patent refuses them because these are administrative procedures, but Türk Patent publishes it, and during the publication period, which is also 2 months in Turkey, you have to, if you think this is, you are as an early right owner, you have to file an opposition to prevent registration of these trademarks. These are, you know, actually these are really long. There's a really long list on our IP law, IP code article 6, but I just put the most important ones that can be of importance for the business owners. For example, likelihood of confusion. In likelihood of confusion, the trademark is not necessarily be identical, because, as you know, identical trademarks will be refused absolutely, provisionally, sorry. But this time, this is similar to your application, to similar applications to your right, or for similar goods and services. Sonex and suffix, let's say. So it's not identical. Türk Patent will publish it for the opposition purposes. But do you think the customer, your target customer, will confuse it with your trademark? So you just file an opposition, and if Türk Patent also agrees that there is likelihood of confusion, they will refuse the application. This is another one, is also a big issue for the companies who are also, you know, doing importing and exporting activities. They, of course, they most of the time have distributors or agents or resellers in other countries to sell their products. But sometimes that agent or representative or reseller can file an application in that country in their own name, not in your name as a trademark owner. I mean, they sell your products, but they know that it's your trademark, but they will file the application, that trademark, in their own names. And early right owner can prevent this as well. It's just a matter of proving. So no need to be put a big effort on this. It is also a genuine earlier use in Turkey is also matters. For example, if you haven't registered your trademark in Turkey yet, but have been using your trademark for a long time in Turkey, because it should be used in Turkey to ground on this reason. If you prove that you've been using your trademark in Turkey before the registration of the application of third party, then you can oppose the trademark and you can prevent the later application. And also bad faith applications, this have been introduced in our new law in 2017, explicitly, let's say. So if you prove that the applicant was filed the application knowing your activities and knowing your facts, or you had a relationship or somehow in bad faith, you can prevent the registration of this mark as well. So how do you protect overseas your trademark? First class system, I will just pass by. There are classifications to protect the trademark. You can't just say, my trademark should be protected in everything, like in textile, to the computers, to the toys, to the chemicals and everything. No, you can't do that. So you need to pick classes or goods and services to protect your right. And, you know, it also causes, the official fees will be calculated depending on the classification. So Turkey is a part of a member of international NIST agreement for the classification of goods and services. So, of course, all the countries of NIST members have their local classifications, but in accordance with the NIST agreement. So, for example, if computer software is in class 9, you know that it's also in class 9 in the UK, in the US, wherever the country is. So, this is a really good help for examiners and also later trademark owners, so that they can search trademarks, registered trademarks applied. So overseas application, there's a, Erdem also told you about patents and utility models, but this is for all IP rights actually. There's a principle of territoriality. That means if you register your trademark in Turkey, then it is protected in Turkey. not in the EU, not in the UK, not in the US. You need to, if you want to protect your trademark in these jurisdictions as well, you need to apply for registration in these countries as well. So how to do that? There are three ways actually to protect your mark in the other countries. One would be national application. You need to, for national applications, you need to use local representatives that can be address of service or, you know, it all depends on the law of that country. For example, for Turkey, you have to have a, you know, a Turkish authorized registered Turkish trademark attorney to be represented by someone. But, you know, if you have a domicile in Turkey as well, you can file your application through directly to the office, but it needs Turkish and it needs, you know, some kind of knowledge as well. So for, let's say, for you want to protect your mark in Taiwan as well, so, and you want to go with national application, you need to use a Taiwanese attorney, Taiwanese trademark attorney to, you know, protect your right. But of course, you cannot find a good Taiwanese attorney because you are so unfamiliar with this jurisdiction. So your attorney in your country can also help this because we, as trademark attorneys, we have international conventions, international annual meetings in every, you know, for maybe for three or four times in a year. So we have networks, we know who to work with. So you can just go directly to your local attorney for the protection of these rights in the other countries as well. But of course, you will pay your attorney and also Taiwanese attorney and also official fees as well. So this might be a little bit costly, but if you just have few countries, just or one country that you want to apply, this can be a little bit faster and more reliable, so can be chosen. For regional applications, it's like one application protects in whole region, like EUTM in EU, OAPI in French speaking African countries, Benelux, Belgium, Netherlands, Luxembourg, one office for them, and etc. And also international applications to Madrid Protocol. So to ease this protection, there is an international convention called Madrid Protocol. This is managed by WIPO. WIPO is WIPO stands for World IP Organization. So you just file, you know, it is managed by WIPO to all countries. Like it's like your national attorney, national contact person for the other countries. So you file just one single application in English, in both for UK and for Turkey, you file it in English. And you can protect, you know, there are members of 107 members covering 123 countries. So it's not like as a whole protection, but you just choose the countries you are of interest and then apply, you know, calculate the fees and then go on with the protection. But you will, you need an office of origin and you need to file your trademark first at your office of origin, which means if you need to be a national or you have a, you need to have a domicile or real and effective industrial commercial establishment in that country. For example, if you have a business in Turkey, you can use, you can first file before Türk Patent to your trademark and extend your trademark to how many countries would you, if you would like, as many countries as you can for 123 countries. So I'm just passing this because the time is not very good. So I'm going to explain designs a little bit. Designs protects the appearance of your product, shape of your product. So it's not functionality, or it's not, you know, just what you see is protected, to protect what you see actually. So it can be the line, contour, color, shape, material, texture, ornamentation, anything can be a subject of a design. But also complex products can be subject of a design only if they can be visible. So you can only protect visible parts of the product. I mean, when visible parts of the product, when I say, it doesn't mean, let's say for car engine, when you open the car engine, if you can see it, then it can be protected. So other criteria, the criteria for designs, is novelty, it should be new, and it should has an individual character, and it should, it should be different from the other designs. So here you see here you can see some examples of the design protection. So registered, as we said, you can continue protecting with registered rights. But also, there is an option for designs that is called unregistered designs. It is also applicable in the UK and in the EU as well. These designs can be protected up to 3 years, but you have to first disclose it to the public in Turkey. So if you have a design that you just put in sale in Turkey, make the public disclosure in Turkey, you can protect it for 3 years for the identical ones, not for the similar ones. So it is, you know, not very advantageous, but still some kind of protection. So Turkey is also a member of Locarno Agreement for the classification of goods. So these are, also is the grouping the products for the designs. For overseas protection, again, national application is possible, region application is possible, and for designs, it is not Madrid Protocol, but this time it's Hague Agreement. And there are 74 contracting parties covering 91 countries. And you can file in just one design up to 100 designs via single application, and you can pick the countries whatever you want to, you have the interest of. So copyrights, it's protected original work of art. This is for, can be musical artistic works, television show concepts, computer databases, software codes, and etc. And actually, copyright exists automatically upon creation in any tangible expression of your idea. And it depends on the artist. As you create it, you have the rights. But the problem here is you need to prove that you have the right, you have the creation date, in case of a dispute with the other party. So whoever proves that he has the right just before the other, it has the copyright. So to do that, to facilitate it, Turkish cult Ministry of Culture gives a you know culture is providing copyright registration services. So if you have copyright in Turkey, you need to you are strongly suggested to register it before Turkish Ministry of Culture. And for this international protection, there is Bern Convention. So for Bern members, you can claim your rights as well. So terms of protection, life of the right, trademarks indefinite. You, as long as possible, forever, you can protect it forever if you register it, renew it in every 10 years. It is also for other countries, mostly for 10 years, but rarely there is some differences, like some countries like 15 years, or some countries starts the protection from the application date, while little some others, few others, starts the date of protection from the registration date. And there also might be some maintenance requirements. Like in the USA, you have to file in every 5 years, you have to prove that you are using your trademark, not to lose it. And for designs, registered designs, maximum protection is 25 years and you renew it in every 5 years. For copyrights, it's life of the owner plus 70 years from the death of the copyright owner. And if it is a legal entity, the copyright owner is the legal entity, it's 70 years from the date of public purchase. Disclosure. And you can, you know, once registered, you can proceed with criminal procedures, compensation of material and moral damages, including loss of revenue. And also you can register your right to the customs to prevent the import and export of the infringer, counterfeiting products. So I think I'm so out of time, so I will give a brief information about Brexit and its effects to IP rights. It is for UK, but you know, since the audience here is also UK related businesses and people, so I just wanted to give this information. As you know, Brexit transition period ended on December 21st of 2020. And after that, all the EU TMs are applicable for 27 countries, except the UK. So the time matters here, that December 21st of 2020 is the key date. If you have EU TM, which is you know, covering also UK until that time, and it is registered, then you don't have to do anything else to continue protecting your right. So it's also still effective in the UK, and UK IPO has just created comparable trademarks for these marks with the UK number. You don't need to do anything, but if you need to do anything for these trademarks, like renew it, change the address or owner it or assign it, or you know, any actions, you need to do it separately from the main EU TM. So you need to have an address of service, and you need to do this action with the someone domiciled there, and also you know, separately from the main EU TM. And if your trademark has not been registered, was not registered on December 31st 2020 in before the EU IPO, then you need to take an action in the UK as well. You need to again pay the official fees, and you need to have a domicile to do that, or someone to represent you with a domicile in the UK, and you need to reapply the mark in the UK as well. But you can keep the priority date, application date of the EUTM. If you do this until 30th of September 2021. It doesn't matter, by the way, even you applied it directly to EU IPO or through WIPO. So for the patents, as the EPO is not an EU agency, leaving the EU doesn't affect the European patent system. So existing European patents also not affected at all. It's just for trademarks and designs, we can say. Thank you very much for your patience. And if you have any questions, please go ahead with the questions and answers.
We'll try. Thank you all for the presentation. It was very informative. We already out of time, but you shared we shared our email addresses. You can address your questions to these email addresses whenever you like. So thank you for your participation and your patience. I hope we could be able to give some valuable information to you. I wish you very healthy and peaceful days. Maybe Ahu, you can say something.
Then yeah, thank you again for your participation. And whenever you need to ask a question, we are always here. And if you also have a specific interest of any of the topics, because we couldn't cover really in detail, just also you can let us know. So we will try to give another one as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.